Hi, it's pretty dark in here. It's pretty kind of, I hope you don't fall asleep because it's early in the morning and a lot of you have been to the party yesterday, I guess. But yeah, I'm Matthias Winkelmann. I'm the head of 3D at Man vs. Machine. We are a London-based design and motion studio. We do a lot of branding and design work for pretty big clients. We don't have a showreel, so I can't show you a showreel. We never had one, we'll probably never have one. So who does know our work, first off? Like, do you know Man vs. Machine, everyone? It's not so many, actually. Okay, I'll show you some of our work. You'll get an idea of it, but I can't show you a showreel. I can tell you a bit about us. The Man vs. Machine was founded in 2007 by Mike Elderson and Tim Swift. In the first years, it was a pretty small studio with about 5 to 6 people most of the time. And since like 2 years, 2 to 3 years, we're growing and we're now about 20 people. And we do a lot of work for Nike. We do work for Apple as well as a lot of TV branding, mainly British TV channels. By now, also several American clients are coming in from the TV world. And yeah, we are based in London, but we are going to open another office in Los Angeles this summer. So we are expanding even more. And but we're always trying to keep our approach of being a design studio, which is pretty small in what it is. Like, we are not like one of the big post houses. And that's also how our team is put together. So all of us are designers. Some are more heavy in 3D, others are more heavy in design, others are getting lost in Houdini. So everybody has like different kind of specialities, but in the end, we're all doing the same kind of work. Because we don't have a showreel, I can show you something else, because Maxon was so nice to visit us last year and shoot a little portrait about us. So to start off and to give you a bit of an idea of who we actually are, I'm gonna show you that portrait.
So I've been working at Man vs. Machine for 5 years, which is a long time, but it feels like I started yesterday. We used to be in a really tiny room and we used to be like 5 guys.
When we were naming the company, there was a bunch of names on the table and there were some that we thought were kind of cool, but they just didn't have the gravitas and the power. And when we wrote them all down and put them on a piece of paper, Man vs. Machine just kicked their ass. It did come from that constant kind of like balancing act between technology and ideas, basically. At the time, there wasn't very much like high-end, very well-executed visual effects or 3D. It seemed to be that things were either really nicely designed and the execution was lacking slightly, or things were really well-executed but the design was lacking slightly. So we decided to just try and take that corner, that market, basically. So it was graphic designers, amazing 3D people, just working together. And that was the premise of the company when it started.
Project highlights would probably be the last couple of night films that we've done where we've implemented 3D scanning into our pipeline. The music then. Good design and filmmaking principles don't change. They generally stay the same as time goes on. What really excites people is how rapidly the technology is changing, which will allow us to rethink new possibilities within these fields.
But that's the concept, is that everybody here is really, really good at what they do, so we don't need to be big. It's everybody's worth a person and a half in theory. If there's no kind of conceptual thinking or idea involved, then it's not really for us, because we like to put our stamp on things because that's what we're good at. The mistake a lot of people seem to make is that they think the clients are the enemy in design, and they're not. They want the same thing as you.
A TV channel will have to last for a few years. Like, it needs to be quite timeless, whereas a Nike film might only be used for a couple of weeks. So you get away with a lot of crazy stuff.
We work really well with forward-thinking clients who will let us do experimental stuff, but for the mainstream.
The music bed. When a new project comes in, you never think, oh, we're going to make this project because we want to win an award. You know, it's always just about designing and creating the best project you possibly could do.
It's funny with awards because before you've won a couple, you pretend that they don't matter. You're like, oh, awards, it's, you know. But then as soon as you win a few, it's like the best thing ever. The music thing. It's all about the work. Every job you do is your PR, it's your reputation. So we do want to be the best studio in the world. That's got to be our aim. You know, we may never achieve that, but that's got to be our aim. We want to be the best at what we do. The music bed.
All right, that guy who looks kind of like me is not me, but he looks kind of like me. But that was Mike. He's one of the founders. He's kind of the creative head of Man vs. Machine as well. And yeah, he is not me, but he looks like me. I'm still working on my English accent quite a bit. As you might notice, I'm not English. I'm originally German. So I'm actually from not too far away from Stuttgart, but I live in London for a few years now and work for Man vs. Machine. We are in the fortunate position that by now we work a lot directly for clients without agencies involved. We do work with agencies, what we prefer not to, because usually when we do, it's not as pleasant as having the client directly. So for example, for Nike, we do work with the Nike headquarters in California, and we've been working for them for quite a few years now, so they give us a lot of freedom in what we do. So quite often they just come like, here's a shoe, that's our theme, make some cool shit. And then you have to come up with some cool shit. I showed that. So the first cool shit I want to talk about is Nike Air Max Day 2016. We just released that a few weeks ago. It's one Nike project which we do almost every year. It's the Air Max Day when they release their new shoes. They always make a huge campaign. And since we are not only a motion studio, we're also a design studio, we basically create everything. So from the design of the campaign, we create the still frames for the prints, we create the motion stuff, and then ultimately, especially in this case, there were even a company taking our designs, building real sculptures out of it, and put them in the shops everywhere for that campaign. So it's a big bundle of stuff. And this year, it was a lot to deliver. We had like, I think, 5 films and print campaign and loads of other stuff. So, but it's really nice because every year we're trying to do something new and quite fresh. So this year it looked something like that. And we have made 3 of this kind. I'm going to show you one now. If we have some more time later on, I might show you the other ones too. But this is the one I will be talking about a bit more. So this is Tinker. Yeah, as you can see, it's super clean. It's like that's kind of our style in a way. So different than if you work in a visual effects house where you start with like a little bit of smoke and then you add a little bit of flares and then you add more smoke and then you add this and isn't this. We usually do some R&D and then we come up with this. Oh, that's crazy. And then you bake it down. At the end, it's only a line on a color background something. So even in this case, we baked it down more and more and more. Because especially Nike is quite obsessed with really clean graphic design. So we're trying to push that as well. And One thing which makes how we work quite different to other companies, at least that's what I think, compared to the other companies I worked for, is that our R&D phases, so just the research, where we're trying to figure out what we're actually doing, is often longer than the production phase. So we actually had projects where we had like 80% R&D and then 20% production in the end, where we just like chuck everything together and it kind of works suddenly. Which is great because that gives you a lot of possibility to try out things which you normally couldn't. And because we have so much stuff, I'll show you another video, but I will be talking a bit more after that. But because we have so much R&D stuff every time, so we started making development reels where we just put together all that stuff which we created and nobody ever sees, because we still think it's pretty cool. So finding ideas is massively about trying stuff out, and I think that's also why we are using Cinema as our main pipeline tool. We do use other software as well, I have to say that, because it's just fair. But Cinema is where everything lands in the end, and that's where we start and where we end. And it's really good for us, because if you have an idea, you can talk about it for like half an hour and try to make people understand it, or you can sit down for 20 minutes and actually sketch it out in 3D, and then you create stuff like that. And then you show it somebody and says like, oh, no, that looks shit. Then you do something else. And that's what we basically do week after week until we come to the point they see like, hey, this works, this works, this works. But besides doing all that free stuff and the experiments which we can use, we, of course, have to fulfill a client's need. So Nike always has very clear ideas as well, what they want. They give you a lot of freedom on one hand, but there are other things where they are very particular about. And I'm going to talk a bit more about the particular stuff, not the plugin, but the shots. For example, and since this is a Cinema 4D workshop as well, I want to dive a little bit into Cinema and show you how we use it and how we utilize it. The shot I want to talk about is the knitting shot for this project, which was simply, Nike has Flyknit on their shoes. So it's a structure on top of the shoe which is knit. And in almost every Nike film, you have to show how they're knitting it. It's sort of like, you can do whatever you want, but you need to show that we're knitting it. So for example, last year we did this shot, and that's where I started building a rig for this. So that was a close-up of a knitting. This year we're doing this shot, so it's a bit further away from the knitting, but it's still knitting. So we did this in Cinema 4D, and that was like kind of one request from the client of like, yeah, we want to see exactly how knitting works, how our Flyknit comes together. So you start thinking about stuff like that. You find yourself watching YouTube videos of people knitting to understand how it actually works. And it's, you kind of have to do that. It's part of a research process, especially if you want to do something which needs to fulfill a certain technical requirement of visualizing a process they actually use in their production. So I started watching videos of knitting machines, how they actually function, and how the thread shoots up and then goes around the thread in front of it and then ties it all together and all these kind of things. And then you start thinking about how can I actually do that. So you come to the point like, oh, I have an idea how this could work. And then you need to sit down and try it. And in Cinema, you could do different routes. You could either use a cloner and then you have a knitting element, which is this loop. You could use a cloner and just multiply that in hundreds of times. And then you have a knitting fabric sort of thing. Or you could go the complicated route. And I call this talk the complexity of things because very often it's actually easier to make it complicated, which sounds kind of contradictory, but if you try to do the easy way first, then you realize like, oh, it actually doesn't fulfill what we need. But if you sketch out what you want to achieve and then you go down a bit more complicated route in the beginning, then you might end up with a rig or something which actually has a lot more flexibility to produce the thing you want to see. So I'll dive into cinema a bit and click around there to show you some stuff. So for example, this thing here is the knitting rig we used in the last film, which is fairly procedural. Like it all, there's no manual work involved except of moving a null object, two keyframes up and down, and that drives the whole knitting rig. That even drives the offset on the different threads and all these kind of things. And there are some functions in there, so like that you can actually turn off the geometry, so you can actually see it a bit faster. Because that's like sort of the problem with these kind of things, that yeah, they get heavy quite quickly, which a cloner doesn't. But if you think about shots like that, what I tend to do is, again, not think the very straight way, not think like, oh, I have a thread which is flat and I need to make a loop out of it. So you don't think A to B, because then you start thinking about like, oh, I need to animate this, or I need to rig it, or I need to do keyframes to come from A to B. I very often start in a more traditional sense of animation. I think about certain states the thing needs to have. So certain states as the thread needs to be aligned first, and then the thread needs to shoot out, and then it needs to bend forward, and then it needs to tighten up. So if you have already something like that, then you kind of understand what the animation should look like. Then it's only about technically making it happen. So you sort of help yourself through the process by not trying to solve everything in the beginning, but like going step by step, understanding what you need to do first. And then next thing would be what I started doing here is just looking at one element. So instead of looking at the whole knit, I look at one element that exactly needs to do what I wanted to do. You would think like now you have like these splines, but yeah, now you need to animate them. But you can animate almost everything in cinema in a way, because you can always reference something and then just morph between things. So in this case, what I did is I referenced all the splines with matrix objects. So if I make the splines invisible, you will see what it means. And now they are just all points. So that looks much better. So again, it's the thing like, yeah, you would think like, now I just have points, but that's not exactly what I want. But it's the first step to have the control over stuff. So building in MoGraph into a setup like that helps me to have the flexibility of it and being able to animate things. And in this case, if I have my master object, which is referencing all the other objects with what you can see here, with inheritance effectors, then I can actually start animating this by just moving around effectors. So I turn on this thing here. Who is kind of advanced cinema users here? Come on, there are some. I know the first row here, like they all know what I'm talking about. Okay, who knows cinema? Okay. I don't have like. I'll run you through. You don't need to understand everything. I think it's just more about a process of thinking about things instead of like really technically like explaining every detail now, because we only have 1 hour and I want to talk about a few more things. So basically, an inheritance effector makes a matrix object morph from one matrix into the other one. And by having these inheritance effectors here, I can make these cubes. I don't know if you see them on the screen. Oh, yeah, I can see them quite well, actually. By just moving around these effectors, I can now make these cube morph from one matrix object to the other. So they already have like my transition between these different states. So I basically have my animation already in a way. And I have it set up in a way that I can control it quite well. Because if I build like a whole knitting structure, I want to be able to control the moment when it tightens together. I want to be able the moment when it shoots up. And if I do that all in one go, then I need to go back and fiddle around with keyframes and try to make it all sync. But like this, I can just take one of these effectors and move it up, and then this whole thing should move differently. Yeah, now it kind of shoots out like that. Which is not what I want, but it's quite good that I can change it that easily if I would want to do that. So then you end up like, yeah, you would think now he has these cubes, but what should I do with that? there's a way for that as well, because with matrix object, you can throw in a tracer, which then just looks at the point references and creates that spline again. So if I turn off the geometry, I'll see, like, now I have my spline back. And I can just use a spline wrap deformer to wrap around a cylinder around that spline. So now I have my geometry back. So even in the beginning, it looks very abstract, but there's always a way of, when you start with these really abstract frames in between, how you can, like, make the animation work with that. And then ultimately, yeah, you come to the point, I actually want to have the whole surface of that, which I would create some like this. And that's where a bit of Expresso comes in, because instead of, like, using a cloner for this now and cloning it and stuff, I use Expresso because with the cloner, I lose the possibility to change every object dynamically, because they all just become clones, so I can't barely tell them, like, you need to crow now and you need to do this now. And so that's when you start doing things like that, which looks scary to a lot of people, but it's actually, it's pretty straightforward. It's not Houdini, so, which is nice. And I'll show you a little example for that as well, to make it a bit more simple. So, cloning things manually, I actually do that all the time by now, because, yeah, as I said, it just gives you more control over things, and it basically takes away all the restrictions, because you're building the whole process by yourself. And then you can do anything with that. And baked down, this rig looks something more like that. So it's a hierarchy node, which references a structure in your object manager. And you kind of break the result of that. And then you can get a reference to all of these objects which are in the hierarchy. And then you can map a certain position to them, to where they should be. So in this case, it's a spline node which looks at a spline, which is up here, and then I map the range from 0 to the amount of objects I have in the hierarchy to 0 to 100% on that spline. Then you can move the spline and move like that. It's quite funny, because if you're not that much into cinema, you will really think, like, this guy is nuts, why he's not just using a cloner object, because that would have been much easier. But there are some reasons for that. It's kind of trying to explain to somebody what the null object does, because it doesn't really do anything. Should I go more into this? I think I'll move on, because we don't have so much time. So this is basically what I want to show you is thinking a bit differently, like, not always just using the first tools which are on the shelf, but, like, just think about the idea first and the thing you want to achieve, and then sketch that out. Because then, basically, the splines that I had in the beginning are my sketch. That's, like, a really rudimental sketch. I could show that to somebody, and they would understand, oh, this spline needs to do this. And based on that, I can build what I want to have in the end, whatever that might be. All right, I'll talk about another one. It's called Nike Hypervenom 2. We did that last year. It's again for Nike, obviously. Ah, I actually have an excerpt of that other knitting shot that looked like something like that. Could make like a gif out of it. Let's look at Hypervenom. That is, where is it? Hypervenom. Hypervenom is one of these examples where we We really had like almost 90% just R&D research, like, which means like we have a structure in the studio that we have a dailies folder where everybody just chucks in the daily output they make, even if it's just wireframes examples, just like gathering ideas. And in this case, we basically did that the whole time, and one of our directors was putting it together, just like throwing it into edit, seeing how it works. The great thing about this process is that it keeps things fairly experimental, so that is something you couldn't really plan, although like we had a proper storyboard and stuff like that at some point, but you need to keep the freedom there to be able to explore stuff, because sometimes you know, like 9 out of 10 times you're producing stuff which is not cool. Like everybody does that. Like we also do that. We do like high profile work, but a lot of the stuff is like, it doesn't work, it goes to the bin. But then in between there's like this happy accident where you find something which is really amazing and you totally want to use that. And if you give yourself that time to explore, then you kind of keep the momentum, you kind of keep the inspiration and the motivation to do that, because you're always keeping the play into the whole workflow. And yeah, again, we did a development reel for that as well, because we have so much stuff to show. And then looking at that development reel, I just realized something, which I was talking about with Simon Holmedahl the other day, is that, for example, this thing here, it's just a class simulation, but that's kind of how you start, like, oh, I have this idea of at a certain point in the film, there needs to be this impact. And I think that's also how it was in the edit for a while. And then ultimately it develops into something, where is it? That's somewhere here. Yeah, like this. So this is actually still the same cloth animation, just like looks much more complicated now. But you start with like something really simple, and then you feel in the rhythm of the whole thing, it kind of works, it kind of makes sense there. And then you develop it further. And that's basically what you can do with anything. All right, what I want to talk about in this piece here is another shot which had like, it's again kind of the thing of looking at things that are not necessarily the most free ones, but the ones which have very strict kind of limitations. Because very often the free ones are actually the easier ones, but the ones where you need to do something specifically, it's a bit more tricky sometimes. In this case, it's the complexity of expectations, or when a client wants exactly that particular thing. In this case, it was like that shoe had like these facets on the front, as you saw, and the client wanted to see how they push out. So we did a lot of different versions of that and trying to show them exactly what we want, but in the end you just need to, like, you have a lot of complicated stuff, in the end you need to come down to the point that, yeah, he just wants to see the facets pushing out of the shoe. So you need to do that, and then it looks something like that. And it's funny because that, to you, that just is like a short shot in the film, so it doesn't look that important, but it was actually one which was quite a discussion until the end. So it's quite an important thing for Nike, because that's where they see their product. So if they ask you to, hey, we want the facets to be pushed out, all our shoes are 3D scanned. So in that film, we actually didn't retopologize them yet, so they are a pain in the ass in a way, because there are a lot of polygons and you don't want to do anything with them, basically, because it's no fun at all. By now, we do retopologize all of them, because that makes it a bit easier. It's still not it's still not great because it's still a lot of geometry. Or yeah, we use other things like building custom tool sets of like projecting low poly, high poly geometry onto low poly geometry, or the other way around. Or other tools like spline projections and things like that. But anyway, basically, when they come with like, we want to have a great, crazy deformation on the shoe, which needs to look like a photoreal animal, that's kind of the moment where you think like, oh no, you can't do that. So you have to think of ways how you can do stuff like that. And one thing in this example is also kind of a simple, very traditional approach. By looking at sculpting. Let me close that stuff here first. And then... shoe sculpts, here we are. It's gonna take a while to open because you will see why, because they're like, that's not too bad. So again, then you could come in and say like, the facets need to push out of the shoe. You could start like, maybe we need to build a rig for it, and we need to have sliders for every facet, and we need to, I don't know what, like make something really complicated. And we did all that. We kind of started with that, but it often is not the best way. So what I again tend to do quite often is actually just build it, like sculpt it how it should animate. And I quite like that thing. I don't know why. It's in its simplicity, it works really well. So all that shot does is actually, we used the sculpting tools and sculpted several frames of how these facets are coming out of the shoe. And even like in a traditional animation way of like sculpting them first a bit higher and then having them a bit lower later on. And so if I do it like this now, you can actually see how that slowly starts to animate over the shoe. And by doing that, you don't necessarily need to build like a crazy complicated rig or anything, because you do exactly what you want to do in Sculpt, and then you just use a post-morph tag, which is like from character animation, where you can morph between different states of a mesh. And that's really all in this shot. But because we did a lot of R&D on that kind of stuff, I'll just show you another thing which you can do out of that as well, how you can use that in combinations with things. And that will be this here. So if you have these two sculpts, these two kind of states of the mesh, you can either just morph them on a slider, or you can use, based on that really simple approach, you can use some more complicated techniques on top of that to make it look more more interesting. So in this case, it does something like that. So that was one of the R&Ds we had in between. But yeah, again, the client wants them to just push out. They don't want some fancy stuff, so it didn't make it in the film, but it's still kind of quite interesting to look at it. When we tried it originally, we had like several of these shoes there and doing that kind of stuff, and they were all driven by a weight map, which is driven by a deformer. So if I click on the weight map, you see there's actually a color going on. So a weight map basically also comes from character animation. It tells the character where it should deform more and where it should deform less. But you can use it for a lot of things. For example, to drive the animation on such a 3D scan. And how that works, it's again a few of these notes here. Basically, do I have another example of that? Or did I want to build this? yeah, presentation. So basically, if you have this flat plane and another plane, the only thing you would need to take care of is that they both have exactly the same point count, so that Cinema knows how to morph from one point count into the other and push it up. And then with a post morph, you just throw it into edit, and then you have a slider, and you can do this. So this is already like how you can very simply morph between different states of your mesh and create some sort of animation. And if you want to then influence how that should animate, so that it doesn't only... Oh, where are my layers? Oh, I actually did that. Okay. So that you, if you don't want it to only... 1 second, I need to fix something here. This shouldn't go there. So if we want to make the animation a bit more interesting, we can use additional tools on top of that, which are driven by the weight map. So in this case, there's just a morph deformer underneath that, which I don't even know. The morph deformer basically just takes the post-morph tag and gives you the slider on a different object. Then it's here. And on top of this morph tag, morph deformer, there is a restriction tag. And the restriction tag, as it says, it restricts it to something. And that restriction tag is like a small little thing in cinema. It's actually these kind of small little things, if you think about them a bit more, they can do a lot of stuff. Because it doesn't create the effect by itself, but it can help you create a lot of interesting things. Because you can use loads of other input and then restrict other animations with that input. So you can combine stuff together, which always creates like the more interesting things. A restriction tag, basically, just to explain it maybe, really quickly, does... let me do that. So, for example, if I have this object here and I put a displacer underneath it and a noise, then I can use the paint tool, which is here, and paint a weight map on this. So a weight map looks something like that. And then I can drop a restriction on top of this and use the weight map to restrict the deformer to only this particular area painted. So that's basically all what the restriction tag does. And since we know now that the weight map is driving that, all we want to do, this is the wrong thing, is it? No, that's the right thing. All we want to do is just drive that weight map in a different way. So as I showed before, in this case, the weight map is driven by plane deformer, excuse me. And the plane deformer, if I make it visible, you can also already get an idea of if it's visible. Ah, yeah, it should be visible. So you see like how there's some sort of stuff going on. There's the fall off basically scaling outwards from the center point. And I'm driving this by looking at this little rig here. So I have my base mesh, which is the object which you saw over there. And I'm looking at the amount of points it has, and then iterate through the amount of points. So iterations start from 0, which you see down here, 0 to the point count, which gives this point out gives me out how much points are there on this mesh. And that again feeds the iteration feeds into an index. So an iteration is basically it just counts from 1 from 0 to 1 to 2 3 4 5 iteration. Pretty simple. The point node also sources the whole mesh and gives out a point position. And then you have the sample node. A sample node is basically that thing which you can use to map an effector onto anything. It basically wants to have an effector, which is this plane thing here, plane. And that feeds into the node, and it wants to have a position or a matrix in that sense where it needs to look at. So all it does, it looks at this position and asks the effector of how much do you influence me at this point. And since we are having a fall off on this effector, and it's moving outwards. The scale is basically what I animate in this. As you can maybe see if I play it, can you? Yeah, the scale is moving outwards. So that's it's the effector only influences the positional values in that range of the fall off. So that's what basically the sample node is handing me out. And then ultimately it feeds into a vertex map, which is this here. So just looking at it again, it looks like something like that, and then the restriction tag limits our post-morph to just the area where the effector influences it. Make sense? Yeah? Yeah? All understood? All right. I was a bit fast, to be honest, but I was told like I should do 45 minutes, so I'm like always a bit. But since we still have some time, I want to show you the other AirMix stuff, and then we can do some question and answers afterwards. So, as I said, for the AirMix day, we did quite a lot of different clips, and they all look quite different. So there are three different ones, and I'll show you the other twos as well. And the last one. Yay! All right, I was a bit too quick for this, so you really need to have some questions now. Thank you, Sam.
Yes. Thank you for your presentation. Thank you. My question is, we all know those nice and shiny films that Man vs. Machine produces. My question is,
thank you.
Most of the times, as a freelancer, as a company, you have those very nice projects everyone loves, and then you have the very ugly cash cows where you die in agony after finishing. And I would like to know how the percentage is at Man vs. Machine. Is it like Paradise that you only do those nice projects?
So the question is if we have bread and butter jobs, or if all of our projects are just nice and shiny. And the truth is Nike are our bread and butter jobs. So Nike are the jobs which we take for lower budgets and which we just do for fun and which pay our bills. But we have other jobs which are like big and which we can't show, which are a bit more of a pain, but they are not necessarily like shit jobs. They're just like different scale of clients and maybe a bit more corporate. But yeah, the percentage is really small. Like most of the jobs we do are either Nike or channel branding. Like the stuff you see on our website is, I think, 80% also the stuff which we produce. Like most of it is released, and there's not so much which we don't release. So. Sorry. Yes, please.
Just curious, why don't you have
God, ask that guy who looks like me. because it's kind of company ethos in a way. Because every piece can stand for itself. I think, like, if I show you guys two pieces, you will see that we produce solid work and that it kind of shows off a bit what we do. So, I don't know, Mike is quite particular about that. He just doesn't like the cutting together loads of different projects and taking them out of the context in a way, which I sort of agree in a way. Of course, if you're a freelancer, you need a showreel, because if somebody is a freelancer and he writes us an email, hey, I want to work for you guys, he needs a showreel, because we don't have the time to look through all the work. It's as simple as that. But as a company, you sell it a bit differently, I think. So we have like our hero projects, which we usually show if somebody wants to know what we do. But yeah, we never got around to a show a showreel. We also rarely have free projects at the same time. I don't know, maybe it's both connected. Any more questions? Yes.
Hey, thanks for the presentation first. And the question is, how do you guys manage with all this polished and polished work on a technology level as well, not to fall down the rabbit hole of technology and still keep the design level up? How do you guys balance that?
I think it's a lot about what I said in the beginning as well, is that all of us are designers. Like we barely have any like pure 3D guys in there. So some of us are designers which have a more technical background, and others are designers who are very much into like design and like really like traditional typography and these kind of things. And I think that kind of helps. So for example, Mike has a really good eye to see what is like technically what looks good. And he knows if something looks shit, and he's really particular about that as well. But at the same time, he's not a technical person at all. Like he doesn't even want to open cinema or anything like that. So, but I guess that's a good balance in a way, because you have some people who can judge the quality of work but are not technical, and you don't need to be technical to know if something is on the standard which you want to achieve. You just need to have the eye for it, and I think in that way we kind of handle it. we don't always handle. I mean, it's kind of tough because you always need to learn more things. So of course we are constantly pushed to getting more knowledge as well. Yeah. And I told you that before, but like this one, I have to say that because Adam, our head of design, will hate me for it, but Amex Day was still rendered in V-Ray, which is like really old in cinema already. So you can do really good work if you don't always use the newest tools. So yeah, more questions. There was somebody? No? No? All the way in the back, there's one more. Yeah, no. So the question is, how far can we push cinema, and when do we need to switch to Houdini, basically? It's hard to put like I mean, of course, if you have like really heavy procedural stuff, you don't necessarily go to cinema. Although you can use a MoCraft setup, that can get quite heavy as well, or with X particles. But that's the stuff where we know Houdini is stronger, and that's where we use Houdini. But as I showed before in Hypervenom, it's a really good example because like cinema is just really good for us to start with because it's much more intuitive in the design process of like just sketching out ideas. It might not look amazing immediately, but it's really good to just illustrate what you want to do. And then based on that, for example, in Hypervenom, you just have that wave kind of thing on a plane. That shows the idea you have. And then based on that, you can decide, hey, do we do this in cinema or do we need to go to Houdini? And In that case, it was no question that we do that in Houdini because it's just this really high procedural mesh geometry kind of stuff. So I don't know, I think it usually comes down to the point when there are a lot of objects in the scene or a lot of geometry, then you might, or especially the procedural things, then you might go to Houdini. In the end, it's actually everybody's own decision, also in the studio. Like, if you want to do this in Houdini, then go for it. But you still need to be able to do it in a certain amount of time. So, can't really say there's a rule for it. Yes?
My question is following up. How do you exchange the stuff? Do you use the engine, or do you use Alembic caches?
Alembic. It's like, since Alembic is there, it's like basically makes it all possible in a way. So everything is Alembic, because also it just helps when you have a rendering pipeline in the farm and everything. You go for Alembic in the end anyway, because it just saves you problems most of the time. So even the Houdini stuff we do, usually it's still rendered in cinema. So like, yeah, we make an Alembic for that and throw it back into cinema, because a lot of shots, there's also not only one person on it, so maybe there's somebody made it in Houdini, and then another guy picks it up and just wants to do lighting on things, and then lights it. So it's rarely that you can actually say, this is my shot. It always needs to be possible for everybody to work on it. And I think that's why we also tend to build rigs like that, because people can still like use sliders and stuff like that to adjust so that it looks how they want it to look like. Yeah. Any more questions? All right. Thank you very much.